Hey, everybody, it is Patrick McLean. You already know one of your guest hosts. We are pushing through 72 hours of Reimagine 2020 version 4. The cool thing about having, like, getting to the point of numbers like 4 is that you start to get some of the same guests to come back. So we've got one of those right now, Joe LaLuz. Hopefully I got that one right. But before I go on too long, Joe, how's your day? What's been the highlight? What was the highlight of last week? What are you excited for this week?
Oh, man. First off, hi. Thanks for having me back. I'm Joe LaLuz. I'm the CEO of Bison Trails. We're an infrastructure provider in the blockchain space. So we work with some of the world's top custodians, exchanges, asset managers, token holders to help them build and participate in blockchains. Super stoked to be back. And thank you again for having me. Man, how was my day? My day is great. It's actually just kind of getting started where I am today. It's still before noon. So getting going plenty left to do in today. But it's great. It's going really, really well. Last week was a pretty crazy week, especially in like the blockchain and crypto space, especially for a company like ours, because we work with a lot of folks that are kind of building across different parts of the technology stack. And there was there's a lot of news about PayPal, which is a major fintech company, starting to launch and build and launch crypto products. And so that was a pretty big deal for I think the entire ecosystem. And a lot of people were really excited about that. I'm really excited about that. I think it's continuing this message and this sort of vision that, like, you know, the crypto space is being slowly adopted by more and more large companies, which is great. So that was awesome. That was sick last week. I thought that was super cool. We also launched our second product ever, which I'm incredibly proud for the team. And so, the combination of us launching a new product and the market and the space kind of like continuing to expand is very, very, very exciting. And hopefully I get a chance to talk a little bit about that new product on today. But yeah. And then this week, man, I got a whole lot of fun stuff going on this week, including everything from we're onboarding a couple new really, really great folks, really great customers, which for me is like one of the most exciting times for me in a week when I get to see us like actually help and drive change for some of these companies. Also have a few things happening on the Libra side. And so I got a whole lot of fun stuff going on this week. I'm excited.
Thanks for going through that. I like to ask people questions sometimes that just like they have to think.
yeah, for sure. For sure. It's funny. I don't know. It's always funny when you record something in case it's not live, because I don't want to be like, well, it's Monday morning, so I've got an entire week ahead of me. You know, it's just like, well, I don't know when it's actually going to air. So, but
yeah, no, this one will air on Halloween, hence the Mario hat for everyone watching. I'm sure you're either sick of it or love it. But hey, I was looking at it a little bit earlier, and you and I were talking before this about like the new product you guys launch. And, I think just generally I want to hear more, and I think the audience will be interested in hopefully ask some interesting questions about Bison Trails and kind of, you know, what your guys' future looks like. But I want to kind of switch topics here, but real sure. quick, like in the 2-3 minute condensed version for people that don't know, what is Bison Trails? And yep. I think one part you hit on, and if we could tag it on there, who do you think of as your customers?
Yep, totally. So we're an infrastructure platform, and we work with folks that want to interact with blockchains. And that interaction can either be in the form of producing blocks, validating blocks, writing blocks, or reading from blocks or writing transactions. So there's a few different ways you interact with a blockchain. And then there's different types of companies that interact with blockchain. So you could be like a wallet, for instance. So if you open up, if I'm a user and I open up a wallet and I look at like my Bitcoin holdings, for instance, the information about what my Bitcoin holdings are has to come from somewhere. What happens is that app queries a server somewhere. And that could be a public server, it could be a private server. And we are a platform that helps folks deploy highly scalable, redundant blockchain infrastructure to do those things. So process those kinds of queries. If you want to send a transaction, to post those transactions, And then do things like stake and help govern a network as well. So voting and staking as well. So folks that are staking can use our infrastructure to stake. And so our customers look a lot like applications, businesses, or really anywhere where tokens are being aggregated. So some of them are funds as well, or you know, just individuals that are a lot of times like investors in the crypto space, and they want to help stand up these early networks. They want to help participate or govern these networks. They want to help vote on those networks, either on behalf of themselves because they hold a lot of tokens themselves, or on behalf of their customers because they aggregate a lot of tokens. So an exchange might use Bison Trails to help power their staking because they have, you know, a million people that have four dots, you know, and they want to help those people each stake their four dots. And that's a pretty difficult process to do. So we're an infrastructure platform. We build products to, you know, make participating in the ecosystem easier and make participating in the ecosystem safer and more secure. That's kind of been our focus. That's been our focus since the beginning, and that's kind of what our customer base has looked like over the last like little while.
Got it. And like I said, I like to dig more into that, but
sure.
I'll get kind of to the first point that I want to talk about. So I tried to listen to some of your interviews. I listened to the interview Yona and our team did with you last time. Cool. And I'm always like interested just because, you know, we're talking a little bit before this, like I spent, you know, a decade in Silicon Valley. I know just a little bit, like I know many good friends that are bigger Jedis than I am. But I'm always surprised like how much I learned in that like tech world, right? Like that raising venture capital, raising money, building tech products, failing, right? Mm-hmm. And I think to some extent, I think some of that translated over to the crypto space. I also think there were a bunch of new entrants into the crypto space. So do you mind talking a little bit about it? And I know you told your origin story many times. So I want to just like, I want to be careful there.
Yep.
But what was your journey there? And I know you, and one thing that really interests me is you worked with your founder for 17 years. So like, What's that like, right? Like, what did you guys figure out together? And how do you kind of translate that? And what advice would you give people kind of entering crypto now?
Yeah. And you know, I actually think that, I think that's a really good question. I think that every year that the crypto space exists, I think that it becomes more and more mature in different ways. And part of those ways are having existing entrepreneurs, existing capital systems, existing processes kind of bleeding into areas of crypto, which some of it can be really, really good. Some of it can be, kind of bad. It really depends on sort of your outlook and how you think about the space. I can dig into that a little bit more for sure. But you know, the way I think about it is, first and foremost, as a startup founder, I have an incredible business partner. His name's Aaron. We've been working together for, like you said, over 17 years, which is insane. It's insane to think about. The reason why that's insane is because it's actually very, very difficult to start a company. It's an incredible amount. It's an incredible amount of work. It's very hard. It's emotionally very difficult. I like to describe it as every day is either the absolute best day of your life currently, or is the absolute worst day of your life currently. And every single day is either one of those things. There's no sort of like really boring, like middle day. It's either like, wow, this day is amazing. And then like tomorrow's like, oh my God, this day is somehow better than yesterday was. And then it's like, wow, today is literally the worst day of my life. And that process is really, one, it's really hard to do, especially by yourself. That can be a very isolating and very difficult thing to go through. And something that founders don't really talk about very much. And, you know, it's not necessarily glorified, the sort of emotional process of being a founder. Well,
and I will say, I feel like the last year, 2 years, I think you started to see, at least I did, like whatever social groups I'm in, I started to see more documentation about that actually. Mm-hmm. Like, not to kind of go off too far on that tangent, but I do think people are, it appears people are identifying it kind of a founder, you don't sleep, freak out, have emotional roller coasters, and build. Yeah. Cool thing.
Yeah, it's, you know, I think at least through my career, for the most part, entrepreneurship and being a founder has been glorified in a way that didn't highlight any of the sort of difficulties or negatives around it, which is okay. I mean, like even in media, if you look at like the way, you know, starting companies is portrayed in like, you know, pop culture, it's like, it's all like, you know, you make it, you've made it, and like, it's incredible. And it's, this is a, you know, amazing, which is a good thing. Cause it's, you know, being entrepreneurs is fun and interesting and, but it's not for everybody, and that's okay, which is also something I think people need to, you know, everyone needs to sort of realize, like sometimes it's really good and sometimes it's the worst thing, you don't want to do it, you know? But I also think that in recognizing, like you said, like in folks recognizing that it's an emotional process and it's difficult, it can make everybody better. I think that's the whole idea, is it's a very isolating role. And so it can make each other, you know, the entrepreneurs can make each other a little bit better by understanding and learning that and sort of tackling it head on. But without getting too far down that tangent, that's the crazy thing about my co-founder and I working together for so long.
I guess maybe I'll tell you what you're gonna say. Like,
sure.
Do you feel like being battle tested as like in this moment of time, like has it benefited you in the long run?
Hell yeah, absolutely. I think that the more times you go, well, think of it this way: the more times you ride a roller coaster, the less you're afraid or excited or, you know, hit hard by the like ups and downs of a roller coaster, right? It's like you condition yourself to a different state that is really, really, really hard. And so that's what I mean by like, you know, some of the sort of troughs are really low troughs and some of the peaks are really high peaks. But when you kind of get used to it and you understand how to work through them, the parts that are a little bit less in your control, you can sort of move through pretty quickly. And doing that with someone else who's also done that with you is really, really difficult to find. It's the reason why most companies fail, because their partners don't work out. Their partnership doesn't work out. Like truly, like I don't know the actual stats, but I know that there is a stat out there that describes like companies failing because the original founders just did not work well together. And so being able to
people coming together and being unselfish and not having like a freak out moment that blows up everything in the room is like, the odds of that not happening inside of 5 years are pretty low.
Exactly. So now imagine you've managed to make it through 5 years, the ups and downs through 5 years. And, you know, Aaron and I as entrepreneurs have actually gone through a few different things that entrepreneurs go through that can be very stressful. You know, there's a saying that, you know, talks about like some of the most stressful things in someone's life is like buying a home or like a death in the family. And then there's one other one I can't remember, but you know, there's basically like three or four moments in someone's life that are like categorically like the most stressful things in your life. And so just like, imagine you went through like all of those things every year with someone else, you know, for like 20 years, you start to realize that like, you can rely on each other and balance each other out. Like, you know, I will say that, I would say this for sure. And it's funny, like people ask me about this, like on a day where I'm having like my worst day, guaranteed, like my co-founder is having probably his best day, and he actually helps balance me out there. And sometimes we're both having like really terrible days, but we can at least acknowledge that we're both having terrible days and that like we will help each other work through it and get to the next phase. And I think that's incredibly valuable. So to answer your question, like, has being battle tested helped? Absolutely. 100%. There, it's a bit of a trade-off, you know, like folks that haven't been through a lot have that, I'm going to say this wrong, but like a naivete. They're sort of like naive in a sense that like, if everything is a blue sky and you have never seen anything terrible, you have like this ability to sort of like think in a way that no one else can.
you can only model after the data set that you've been given. if you don't have the full data set.
Exactly. So there's like that benefit of not being muddled by like how shit stuff can be or how bad stuff can be. Excuse my language. I'll try not to curse. how bad stuff can be. But at the same time, you have the flip side where the battle tested, sort of operationally tested founders have seen so much that they don't get tripped up by some of the really basic stuff that would cause a company to fall apart in the first 3 years. And that is incredibly, incredibly valuable. And it's something that you don't realize as a founder until you've done it a few times and met other people that have. And it's tough, but
So what were the signs or like products that you guys had worked on in the past that if you were to look back, you would say, I could see trends in the relationship that I was building with my co-founder, things that we were interested in, kind of our approach to problems. Like what were, if you look back, what were some examples that you would give that kind of make now make sense, I guess?
Yeah, I think it's actually kind of funny because I think that there's some advice that says that, you know, in a partnership, you actually want people to be like very different in terms of skill sets so that you maximize how you complement each other. And that's something that over my career, I'm not convinced I believe is true. I think like at first, like I think conceptually, I get why that might make sense. Like if you're really good at, you know, biking and I'm really good at running and we're trying to do a, you know, biathlon, like combined biathlon, that makes a lot of sense. Like we would optimize for, you know, that. What I found is that my co-founder and I over the course of the years have realized that we're both really good at similar things, which means that we're able to challenge each other in those areas. So, you know, you can think of it as like, he might be a better biker, but I'm also a really good biker. And so like I can push him. And similarly, I might be a really good runner, but he's also a really good runner, which means that he can push me. And I've actually found that it didn't really matter the product we were building. It was like our approach to thinking about the products, whether it was like engineering, designing, you know, creating user experience, marketing it. We were constantly pushing each other in a way that made us both better out the other end. And I think that's what was the sign for me. There was that one. It was kind of like, as long as I'm working with someone who's going to constantly push me, trust me, but push me, and I can do the same for them, and that's like really respectful and balanced, then that was really, really helpful. And then the second thing was just no ego. That's like the easiest way to describe it, which I actually think takes time. It's like day one, there was no ego. It took time. We had to communicate a lot and talk a lot about like what we're interested in, what we wanted to do. But the ability to take the ego, put it aside, and realize that we are much, much, much stronger working together than we are combating each other or you know, letting our egos get in the way. And that's something that's really hard. That's something that takes time to learn how to do. Honestly, you have to practice that. We've done everything from co-founder coaching. You know, we've done like communication sessions together. And so I think that's the other thing is that like people don't realize the amount of time and effort it takes to cultivate that kind of a relationship. You know, like any relationship needs a lot of cultivation, whether it's a, you know, life partner or romantic partner or business partner. And I think that if you don't put the time and effort into a business partnership, it can fall apart really, really easily. And if you do, it can be this foundation for like success and like personal success and individual success as well as combined success.
It's much easier to move quickly when you can just have like all close to blind trust with people where you just like, you don't have to like sit around and debate with, you know what I mean? Their intentions like you said, I think it takes time to understand that people might be able to remove ego. Right. And when you find that person, it's like, oh wait, like, are we on the same page? Like you got me? Like I go, all right, cool. Like we don't have to waste time debating dumb stuff.
Yeah. But, no, I was going to say that's 100% true. And it's actually the probably the first piece of advice I ever give anybody. So I do some, Aaron and I do angel investing as well. We invest in early stage startups. We're not like investors, but we do angel invest in companies. And because I like to help companies, and I actually think like the best way to help them is to A, put some money into it, and B, give them advice and like answer questions and be a support system. But one of the biggest pieces of advice I give people is like, set your intentions. Like first thing you do, you know, like people ask like, what should we do in terms of like incorporating or building a company? And like, first thing you need to do is write what we call founder docs. And it's literally just like a document that outlines your relationship with your co-founder. What do you think you're going to be doing? What do they think they're going to be doing? What happens if you guys can't agree on something? What happens if you want to part ways? You know, like what does it actually mean? Like, what if you decide 3 years from now, you just don't want to work on this anymore? That stuff happens. And so like, as hard as it is to like have that conversation in like a honeymoon period when you're starting to work with somebody, it's actually incredibly important to do. And it's like one of the most important things that I think anybody does, because it not only forces you to think about what you want, it forces the other person to, and it forces the conversation about where in areas where you might not be matched up, and starts the sort of resolution of that really quickly.
People tend to shy away from confrontation, I find. Like, even when we have mouth about like an accelerator, like we've seen it enough. Like, it's these questions like, oh no, we trust each other, or don't worry. Like, no, like it's, there's going to be a fight. There's going to be,
oh yeah,
some moment that not being clear, right? Not investing time. And I think in a lot of cases it can even, not selfish, but like people shy away from these conversations because they don't want to rock the boat, right? And they think that by not having it, they'll have a better chance of success. But what they're really doing is delaying the inevitable. And you usually want to have those conversations up front. I think they're a little bit easier and more calm. When you say, do you remember what we talked about in the beginning? There's not a lot of gray here. But hey,
totally.
I'm going to try to pivot us off this a little bit. But yeah. I want to kind of wrap this last part up and say, all right, so you found something super rare. You and your partner worked together for 17 years, a little over. This is awesome. You guys have been battle tested. You've gone through some stuff. Would I be safe to say is Bison Trails your guys' biggest venture today? Is it your most successful, how you would view it?
So I think that we're still very much, I appreciate how flattering that is, but I would say we're still very much in the beginning phases of Bison Trails. We've worked on, I would say that Bison Trails has gotten to a size and scale that is the biggest that we've gotten to in a sort of startup life cycle. When we sold our last company and we joined the leadership team at Etsy, we did work on some things that were pretty big scale as well, pretty large scale as well over there. But that was within the sort of walls of another larger organization. And the company had just gone public. So it was sort of different setting and a different, you know, a little bit more corporate of a setting. As far as, you know, 0 to 1 or, you know, 0 to 1,000 is concerned, Bison Trails is the biggest company by a few, you know, metrics that I would measure. I still think we have an incredible amount of work to do. Like this is day zero still, you know, we're 3 years in. And so, but you know, by amount of capital raised, by size of the team, I think like by the impact we're having on the market that we set out to service, this is probably the biggest that we've had so far.
And do you feel like it's the also then like now about to be the most calm, like you are the most battle tested at the right moment in time that, and obviously, like you said, not to minimize the amount of work that needs to go into it and is ahead of you or whatever, but to say that you kind of finding your form maybe is like you feel most confident you've been.
That's a good question. I don't know. Truthfully, like I don't actually know. I don't know what tomorrow's going to be like. It's either going to be one of the best days of my life or one of the worst days of my life.
You've had a pretty big smile on your face this call, so it feels like you might be in good spirits.
I was talking to somebody recently that like was another founder that I respect a lot that was telling me that they believe one of the best things companies can do is optimize for fun, because if you optimize for fun, the people around you will inevitably do incredible things instead of like optimizing for revenue. They'll do incredible things and try new things that like no one else would want to try.
Mario hats, and all the
costumes. Yeah,
all the employees are happy.
Yeah, so I think I have a big smile on my face because I optimize for fun a lot, and I really love working with incredible people. Like for me, it's like, how do we have a good time? How do we have impact? How do we work on stuff that we care about? But there is something interesting to say about what you're saying, which is like, is this a perfect storm of like, sort of like, you know, amount of experience and market timing and all these things. And like, there's probably something there. There's for sure a whole bunch of luck involved in that too. Like that's the other thing people don't talk about when it comes to starting companies or entrepreneurship or being a founder, is that you can have a great idea in a great market with a great co-founder and you just you didn't time it right. You know, like it's like, and it's not your fault. You know, it's like you believe this will happen, but the things you believed were going to happen didn't happen yet. And I've seen plenty startups fail because of that. And it's not because they did anything wrong. So I certainly think there's a lot of things intersecting all at once that I'm humbly very, very excited about and considering where we are as a company. And then, you know, I still think we have a ton of stuff to do.
So what was that? What was your biggest timing luck moment in Bison Trails? Like, if you look back, you'd be like, if this day didn't happen, like I wouldn't be sitting here right now.
Yeah. I actually don't think there was a day. I think it's like a series of events that like you don't realize connect down the road, as opposed to like a day that happened. So before we started Bison Trails, as it were, First off, Aaron and I were already kind of involved in the crypto space in general. Like we were had been doing some investing, had been following, you know, Bitcoin and Ethereum pretty closely. We're really interested in it even before we were building anything in the crypto space. So there's that is already like something. Then the timing around when we decided we wanted to jump in was like pretty fortuitous. It was, you know, it was right around like right before the like crazy bull run of 2017 happened. So it was like in 2016 going into 2017, we were like, this is a really cool space. I think there's a lot of potential here. Let's build something. We also, our backgrounds made us really, really interested in the infrastructure behind the space. So the first thing we looked at was infrastructure. We weren't like, let's just figure out what's a good business. We were like, this is something that's crazy. It's going to power these decentralized distributed systems. How does that work? You know, and dug really deep. And we did some really unscalable things. Like we built a proof of work mine. That was like an incredibly lucky thing to have gone through and done because it made us experts in how blocks are produced and formed, how networks are secured, how difficult that actually is. And so we did all of that. And it just happened to be that like the timing was lining up perfectly where we were seeing a shift in the market away from proof of work and towards newer consensus models like proof of stake and, you know, nominated and delegated proof of stake and all this stuff. And so we found ourselves squarely in this position where like we were experts in like how infrastructure worked in the blockchain space, experts in software infrastructure, and this market was kind of tilting away from how this works into like something that we were really well positioned to do. So it's less so like there's a day and more like a series of events that happened that like we tried a bunch of different things and then realized, holy crap, like we're really well suited to solve this specific problem.
Well, for other founders or college students or whatever watching this, general blockchain people, like,
yeah,
what would you have? And I think there's always like this train of thoughts, like, is it luck or did I put myself in this position, right? Was it engineered luck?
Yeah.
How do you kind of measure that, like, after, especially with your founder after so long working together? Like, yeah. I think we talked, I have a partner working for 10 years, our CTO, so I understand a little bit. I'm about halfway to you guys. But, like, I just feel like our flow sometimes is, like, we kind of thinking the same thing or having conversations and maybe playing around in different areas to position for luck.
Yep.
But how do you guys kind of approach that?
Yeah. Well, first things first is you can't get lucky if you don't do anything. So the first
piece of advice. You have to buy the lottery ticket.
Optimize for doing something always. You know, like if you think you want to quit your job to work on something, quit your job to work on it. You can always go back and get a job afterwards. If you're thinking about, you know, whatever, dropping out of school, not going to work because you're passionate about something, do that. So there's a couple things. The first thing is like, if you're not doing it, there's no chance. So do it. The second thing is everyone, and I like to joke about this, like Aaron and I have built three companies in the past. There's probably 30 companies that are dead skeletons behind those three companies that we never talk about, that I'm not sitting on a podcast talking about, like, you know, that really shitty app that we built that like after 2 months we're like, this is stupid. This is just like a bad idea, you know? And so like iterating constantly is important. So first you gotta like, you know, optimize for, you know, you have to, you know, bias for action. You have to optimize for doing something. You have to be okay with the fact that you're gonna fail. That's like inevitable. It's not a I don't know if I will. You will 100% fail at something, and that's okay. And you just got to be able to keep moving. And then the third thing is like, you know, do what you're passionate about. And I know everybody says that, but at the end of the day, like think of it less so about like, hey, can I do this for a year or two? And more like, do I want to do this for the next 20 years? And I think that was the big thing about us moving into the blockchain and crypto space. We looked at it as like, and this came from, I feel very fortunate to be able to make that decision. But like, I was like, I want to work on something that I care about, that I think will be impactful for the next 10 or 20 years. And the crypto space to me was the inevitability that I needed to work on. And so I knew that like,
those elements? Like what drew you, like what were the principles there?
Yeah, I think, I think it's less like, there's the ethos of the space, which I think is really interesting. It's like sort of rooted in this idea of like empowering people and empowering individuals. And I personally, I believe in that very strongly. So There's a bit of that, and the space takes that on in different ways, you know, and Bitcoin has its own way of doing that. Ethereum has its own way of doing that. And, you know, everybody has opinions about it. And I think that's, honestly, I think that's magical. I think it's incredible. So, so there's that, there's the ethos of the space. There's also, a couple of things that I say are harder to put my finger on, but maybe just like alarm bells were going off in my brain of like, Joe, you've seen this stuff before. Some signals to me that were like, the blockchain and crypto space is the future, and what is happening in the crypto space is the future. The biggest one is that, like, a couple of times in my career around mid-2000s, when like the mobile movement was happening, this happened, and then again in the early 2000s when like the initial internet was kind of coming together, I was noticing these like pockets of like pretty esoteric, like closed off, very technical, very nerdy groups forming, and people having really heated debate about the kinds of stuff. Like, looking out from the inside, you'd be like, this makes no sense, and I don't understand why these people are fighting about this. But if you were in it, you would realize.
You're talking like platform wars, things like that, like coding language debates.
Platform wars, language debates, optimizations, protocol debates, like. I guess like if you weren't in it and you weren't like nerdy enough to understand it, you don't know that there was protocol debates in like 1996. Like, people were arguing about like what protocol to use for email, you know, like it's like these were real things that were happening, different standards, different, you know, like the kinds of things that are the fundamental baselines for new technology and what drive technology for the next 10, 20, 30 years. And I was seeing that in the crypto space. So like you know, one of the first things I did was like wanted to meet more people and read their white papers and then ask them questions and learn and get to know folks. So I spent a lot of time doing that. I spent probably about a year just doing that and realized that some of the smartest and weirdest people I had ever met in my entire life were working in the space. And that's like the number one green light. Like, that is, to me, is like the alarm bell is going off and the signal is like, Joe, this is something you're going to love and you're going to care about. And that's what happened.
Do you use that? Do you try to use that as a strategy now? Like, because I mean, I'm assuming, I guess assuming is the right word, that like you guys have to say about new tech, like, what do you want to support? What do you want to integrate with? Are you still kind of sitting back and carefully choosing what you think? And then I guess kind of leads into like another portion I want to talk about, but like, where do you guys kind of view your role in being kingmaker or integration maker or whatever you want to call it?
That's way too generous, but I get the basis of the question. I got to say that like that feeling is not about like any one protocol. It's about the ecosystem. It was about like how blockchain and crypto could affect the world, how transfer of value networks are going to power every computer system that we use in the future. And we won't even notice it. Like, when people talk about when is crypto going mainstream, in my head, that has nothing to do with like, when is my dad buying Bitcoin? You know, like when is my grandma like asking me about Bitcoin? That's not the sort of signal. To me, the signal is, when is it powering every system in the background and nobody even notices it? You know, no one even knows that that's there. No one even realizes it because we've built products and services that make our lives easier and better. You know, I can easily send money to you wherever you are in the world. And I don't even know this necessarily on blockchain or using crypto networks as a mechanism to do that, but it's easier for you. It's easier for me. And it's, you know, those kinds of things are life-changing. So, so for me, it was more about the ecosystem as a whole, not about like any particular protocol. As far as like,
but I guess to clarify my question there, like, yeah. Are you still actively, like, do you see those little pockets popping up? I mean, like, okay, all of a sudden everyone's talking about Solana, right? Or like, mm-hmm. do you think that's like a critical part going forward to really, that like every time these new technologies pop up or new protocols or new approaches, that it's going to be so obvious that like venture money comes in and it's like, there's this neon sign around the company that's like, we're the next thing? Or do you think that there is still a lot and kind of benefits for companies, maybe like Bison Trails or other providers that kind of work across a variety of technologies to kind of identify those things early and maybe support them or help push their adoption?
I think, okay, so the second part of that, yes, help support them and push their adoption, definitely. And that's what we're trying to do. I think the first part of your question is more of an art than it is a science. And it's really hard even for me to like articulate that that like how to identify that. So yes, I am seeing those pockets, but like, I'll give you a good example. And you brought up Solana. I didn't bring up Solana, but like 3 years ago, I saw, I think it was a talk, maybe it was Vitalik that was talking about Ethereum, and Anatoly, who's the founder of Solana, was like yelling at him from like the crowd, asking like some really pointed question. I was like, this guy's super interesting. Then was like, I want to meet him, figured out a way how to meet him, had him explain Solana to me on a whiteboard in his like tiny office, which there was like three people in. And I was like, this is sick. Like, this is the craziest thing I've ever seen. And fast forward 3 years, and they've like, you know, built a massive team and a community and you know, launched a protocol and are doing some really cool stuff. But for me, where the alarm bells went off was like, this is a really interesting, super intelligent person that I want to understand more about how they think, you know, and then did everything I possibly could to understand more on how this person thinks. And that included showing up at his office at 7 a.m. so he can whiteboard like his vision that, like, honestly, like, compared to how I think about what he's trying to solve, like, it was like 100,000 times bigger and like broader and like way more thought out than anything I could come up with, you know. And then followed up with him and continued to talk to him, and so, you know, I'm a you know, huge fan of that type of thinking, of like sort of finding and identifying these like pockets of people that are, you know, just so far out there, you know, so far thinking about like just the craziest things. And to me, Anatoly from Solana is like a really great example of someone who like has a tremendous amount of experience in like one area and is applying that within the blockchain space in a way that's like really different and far out from where everyone else is.
Well, and kind of in that, and I was talking to Kyle Samani yesterday, actually, like one of the, yeah, right, so we were, so I'm always like generally curious, because I think like from my, and I came a little bit late to it, but from my like bird's eye view, it was like, there was too much noise in the space for a minute, right? Like, mm-hmm, 2018. And I feel like there was, obviously we've seen some scams or whatever, some people had bad taste in their mouth. And I think the pendulum swung very far to like the other side. So I think there was like this period where like everything was looked at in a view of skepticism, you know? Yep. And I think, so there was like this kind of like quiet period where people actually just like put their heads down and were building. Yep. So I guess, yeah, I mean, I just generally, I'm curious of your points, like having seen traditional markets or traditional tech companies, traditional venture money, where do you think the market kind of is right now in that lens? Like,
yeah.
Do you see kind of an aggregation of resources around, and is there a new baseline that people need to hit?
I think that the crypto space over the last few years has learned a bit from the more traditional tech space, and vice versa. I actually think that the pace of innovation in the crypto space is unrivaled in any tech space. It just doesn't, no one else is moving as fast as the crypto space. Like, even if you just looked at DeFi, decentralized finance, and like what has happened in decentralized finance, the crypto space has iterated over like 100 years of financial innovation in like 3 months. You know, it's insane to even wrap your head around. And so I think that, you know, the learning from the skepticism from folks looking outside in is kind of normal because of what happened with like the sort of like crypto bubble-ish thing in 2017. But also the folks that were like true believers have stuck around and are continuing to build stuff through this, you know, quote unquote, through the quote unquote bear market, and continuing to iterate and build better and better products and better platforms and better protocols. So I think like the thing that, you know, the venture world or, you know, sort of Silicon Valley tech can take from crypto is the experimentation and the iterative pace and the innovation pace, which if I was a founder in like Silicon Valley not working in blockchain or crypto, I would be jealous of. I think, honestly, like, I would be looking at that and being like, holy smokes, like, these people have convinced, you know, billions of dollars to lock in like experimental protocols to be able to support like looking at what it looks like to, you know, create like automated market makers and like lending this stuff's insane. Like, this is unbelievably insane that like where we are today. And so I think that that's actually bleeding over into like, you know, Silicon Valley tech. Like how do we bridge the gap a little bit about around like applied technology? And because crypto's done that super well. That's like one thing that crypto's done super, super well is like taking things that are still research and basically applying them into like real life scenarios and testing them out in a way that's like, you know, at pretty good scale. So I think there's sort of that piece. I think that we're going to probably, markets sort of move in the way that markets move, and they, you know, ups and downs kind of thing. And I think that we're going to continue to see more and more innovation and more investment in the crypto space as the market matures. And that's kind of like tying back what we originally talked about, is that like over the last, you know, 5 years, the crypto market has matured in a lot of different ways. And one of the ways is, how do we identify areas that we can make the entire ecosystem better? And we're starting to see more and more companies trying to achieve that mission. And I think like Bison Trails falls squarely in that as well. So we were formed in 2017. We weren't an ICO bubble, you know, we were like an ICO bubble kind of investment. Now we were looking at this as like long-term 10 years, how do we make this entire ecosystem better? And sort of, you know, turning a blind eye or ignoring the fact that, like, you know, in any market that's doing well, there's going to be hype and there's going to be scams, and then they'll go away, and then they'll happen again when there's more hype. And that's just kind of like how markets work. So.
All right. Well, I know we're getting close to the time. You tell me whenever you got to cut it. I think we got a little bit, but I want to pivot okay. here.
Sure.
I'm going to take it back to things that bring smile on your face and talking about building cooler and better things in the market. Yeah.
Let's do it.
You guys just launched a product. What are some things that you, what have been some of the innovations you feel like Bison Trails and your team has been working on the last, I don't know, whatever period you want to measure, 6 months, a year, that you think are like really awesome? Tell me about some of the new stuff and kind of caveat, bolt onto that and say, how do you guys measure success? Like, are you measuring it? And I'm sure it's not a black and white answer, so I'm sure it's in product delivery and customer adoption, but I'll kick it to you.
Yeah. So again, I'll answer these questions backwards because we built some really cool stuff and we just launched a new product, and you know, I'd love to kind of talk a little bit about that. But the way we measure success is, at least in today's world, we measure it in terms of impact on the ecosystem. And so that's in terms of, you know, how much more distributed, decentralized, how much easier and faster we can make it for folks to build on protocols and in the blockchain space. Those are things we care about. Alongside that, there's, you know, other more pointed metrics around like customer adoption and, you know, traditional sort of startup metrics like ARR and, you know, dollars coming in, or, you know, crypto coming in and what we're spending and all the other regular metrics you would want to have at a company. But we believe we're A, in the early stages still. So focusing on impact is way more important. And B, our mission is about growing the space. And so we're not looking at this as like, how do we capture a part of this market? But we're more like, how do we make this market 1,000 times bigger, literally 1,000 times bigger? How do we 1,000x this, the market? And so the products and services we build are geared towards 1,000xing the market versus taking a piece of the market that exists, which is in line with the products and services we've been building. So working my way backwards through those questions, a couple of things we've worked on that I think are just absolutely astounding, that, you know, are standouts in the space. The first thing we did, which we launched, or, you know, we quietly launched a couple months ago now, was we built software to avoid double signing. We call it double signing protection software. So one of the issues, this is a little bit technical, but one of the issues in proof of stake protocols is the risk of slashing. And that's basically when someone acts, you know, against the protocol, or they do something wrong in the sort of consensus of the protocol. You get penalized financially for doing that. There's a few ways you can do that, and we've written software to make it so that it's near to impossible to do it. It's not impossible because nothing's impossible, but written pretty state-of-the-art software to be able to avoid that. The second thing we did, which I think is incredible, is we've been working on some really robust, what we call global blockchain syncing tooling. So blockchains are distributed all over the world. There's a lot of data that moves very slowly. And so if you want to interact with a blockchain, and you want to do that in a way that has like lots and lots of robust trace information, it can take weeks or months to sync information from the blockchain so that you can use it. And we've made it so that can happen in a couple of hours, which is astounding. So if you're a company and you want to build on EOS or Ethereum, you want to Ethereum. I mean, I don't know if anybody, what people are building on. I know people are building on lots of different stuff, but let's just say like Ethereum, because I know there's a lot of builders in Ethereum. But if you want contract level trace information in Ethereum, you need to run an archival node in Ethereum, and we make it incredibly easy to deploy and launch one of those in like an hour, as opposed to in a few weeks. Let alone like the stability around it is perfect, so you don't ever have to worry about like making sure that it's still up and running and et cetera, et cetera. So those are two things that we've launched that are incredible. They're also sort of some of the baseline for this new product that we launched. So last week we introduced this product called QT. It stands for Query and Transacting. It's a basis for a gateway into the blockchain space. And we launched it across 40 protocols that we support, including the proof of stake protocols that we're very well known for helping stake and produce messages and blocks on. We also added support for a whole bunch of proof of work protocols like Bitcoin and its forks and Bitcoin Cash SV and Litecoin and Ethereum and Ethereum's forks. So if you're a company that's building or adding support for new protocols, we are an incredibly easy way to get secure, reliable access to those protocols. Especially if you're doing stuff like data analysis, ML, and you need to do like some really, really difficult sort of sidecarring, or if you need to build like an index database alongside blockchain data so that you can then, you know, query it, that's a really difficult thing to do. And we do that super well. So I'm super pumped about that product. The reason why I'm pumped about that product, and we talked about this a little bit earlier in the conversation, is because part of our mission is to expand this ecosystem and make it so that a lot more companies and a lot more entrepreneurs can build in the space. And right now, if you wanted to build a data company or an accounting company, or you know, any kind of company that would help the space, you would have to build all of these pieces of infrastructure yourself before you could even get started on like the application you want for your end users. So like if I wanted to go build a data visualization company, I got to go spend, you know, 50% of my time just making sure that I can get like secure, reliable access to trace archival nodes in Ethereum, let alone 40 other blockchains, and then go and build the charting and data analysis on top of it, and then go and build sell it to people and convince people to use it. So we basically take this huge chunk of the development stack and say like, okay, you don't have to do that anymore. Now build these pieces that are going to drive more value to more folks. And that's really exciting for me, because it's aligned with like our mission of making the space bigger and better and helping folks build in the space.
For anyone who doesn't understand what Joe just said, he said actually a lot of pretty technical, complicated stuff, but he made it sound really simple.
I'm sorry.
No, I guess that did go a little technical. Actually, no, it didn't. It was actually a very, very good explanation. I'm saying you made it sound almost too easy. People actually need to go look into what you guys are doing. What he's talking about is not easy. But I'll frame it in this context, like because like there's a bunch of students watching, right? We help, like yep. We've seen enough like hackathons, whatever. Our team has like a core. We have like, I've had 50 engineers for 3 years. We do a bunch of like engineering stuff.
Yep.
So we kind of watch that in a little bit different light, I think, than other groups because of that. But so do you guys really have a big initiative to kind of drive? Because then I'll say like, let's talk about like a hackathon, right? Where like students yep. might want to come in. They don't have any experience with blockchain, even setting up a node, all of this. With the Infura type model, like, do you guys have like a big developer outreach? Like if I'm a student or developer watching this right now, like what can I do right now to like go speed up my development with Bison Trails?
Yeah, so I would say, so first of all, I love that you said speed up my development with Bison Trails, because I actually think that that's an unsung hero in the space. When I said that we save people weeks of time in syncing like an EOS or an archival node on ETH, I meant it. It actually takes weeks. It's unbelievable.
People have no idea. Yeah, people have no idea how shitty blockchain development has been for so long. Like
yeah.
all of these normal tools you would find in yeah. other forms of development. Like I've always looked at why aren't there more developers in blockchain? And I can yeah. kind of have like this matrix. I won't go too long into it, but like definitely some of the infrastructure is missing. I didn't mean to interrupt you, but yeah, speed up development.
No, I just, it's one of those things that like, I sort of gloss over because I'm really excited about what we're doing. But like when you save someone weeks of time, it's almost unfathomable. Like developers often think about like, how do I save myself seconds, minutes, let alone like, I'm not even going to go near that thing. Like I remember when I first started building, and this is a lot of the basis for how we built Bison Trails, but Aaron and I started working on building, we were building like a wallet. And we were like, okay, cool. So we'll spin up an Ethereum node and like come back and work on this next week. Like it just didn't, like something clicked, you know, like something clicked in my head. And I was like, this doesn't make sense at all. So anyways, I've already forgotten what the question was.
I was saying like what you guys do. I have a new one already. That
okay.
Just said. So like, I would say even unfathomable. And honestly, you might be kind of right when you say that, because I can't imagine how many projects actually haven't happened because these initial barriers were such a pain in the ass that like, you know, it's like companies like IBM or who Nvidia, Intel, they ship out little demo boards, right? Like I worked in the hardware space for a long time. Like there's a whole theory, right? Of like giving developers access, API, like making things simple speeds innovation, right? So, but my general question is, what is your guys' kind of role there? Like, how are you approaching it to like let developers know or let students know what can they maybe do with Bison Trails if they wanted to spin it up or any programs you guys have?
Yeah. So, I'll just open with this. First thing is like, if you're a developer or you're building something or you're a student and you want to work on it, shoot us a message at hi@bisontrails.co or just go to bisontrails.co/contact. And reach out. We always want to hear from people that are building stuff. That's how we make our products better. That's how we make our platform better. So we'd love to know if folks are working on something interesting and they want to, you know, they don't know how to get started. I gotta be fully transparent. We've built this. We're still working on some of the pieces around like outreach to developers and outreach to students and people getting started. So I mentioned this before, like we launched this Qt product. And rather than launch it with like, hey, this is starting from nothing, we actually spent a year building and iterating on it, working with some alpha partners so that it's already at scale. So we can support, you know, really large scale financial services companies that are building like huge, you know, they have millions and millions of users already, which was part of our strategy. We wanted to build something that was like incredibly transformative for the space as opposed to, you know, something that was kind of incremental. What that means is that we haven't finished building out some of the sort of programs around like, how do we outreach to developers at hackathon or how do we get folks to, you know, understand what it means to build across two different blockchains at the same time. Those are things we're working on. So if you want to help us do that and you're a student out there watching or you're an entrepreneur watching and you want to help us understand what some of those interesting products or projects or ways you would use the platform are, definitely reach out because we'd love to hear from you. What that means is that the product today is mostly used by folks that are like, I would say one stage past, like we're at a hackathon and we're just getting going. It's more like, oh, I have like a wallet. It's really interesting, but I'd like to add 12 more assets. And that's going to be an absolute disaster for me because I only support Bitcoin right now. And I have to now support, you know, Tezos and Ethereum and Polkadot and Cosmos and stuff. And that's just really, really hard to do. And so that's kind of like where it is geared today. Or you're like a, you know, large scale custodian or exchange and you're in the same spot, which is like, whoa, these new DeFi protocols just came out. I need to add support for them. And I need to be able to read and write from these chains or secure these chains. So it's something we're still working on. That bit is something we're still working on. It's something that we're trying to get a little bit more information from the market and from folks that want to build in the space on like how we can make it better for them.
Well, we'll help you with that. I'll talk to you one off. I mean, we can introduce a bunch of students. And
yeah, that'd be great.
I think it's, we just did a deal like I'm Thailand because we're here now for a bit and like literally every university, right? And like I just met with them and it's kind of the same issue. It's like, I think there's this baseline between like just the hurdle to get up is so far that there's like a lot more innovation out there in blockchain. And I'd actually like to see more about how Bison Trails could help with that.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, hey, I know we're running a little bit over. This is one of those calls I'd like to continue. But before we go, any last thoughts? Anything on your mind you want to go over?
So first and foremost, I just want to say thanks again for having me on. It's super fun. And as always, really, really engaging and really interesting conversation. So thanks for, you know, having a chat with me. And And, you know, letting me talk a little bit about what excites me about Bison Trails in the blockchain space. I think, I'm, you know, always humbled to have, you know, really engaging conversations about that. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that if you want to learn more about Bison Trails, anyone watching or listening, you can go to bisontrails.co, bisontrails.co/contact if you want to reach us, or just email hi@bisontrails.co.
What are you going to be for Halloween?
Oh God. I feel like the world is scary enough as it is right now. I'm not sure I need to add any, any additional, scariness to it. No, I don't know. I was, I'm a hidden huge fan of The Nightmare Before Christmas, and I'm constantly in debates with people if that's a Halloween movie or a Christmas movie. So Jack Skellington is always on the table for me. I'm a big fan of Jack Skellington, which I'm also like kind of tall, and he's sort of like tall and lanky, and I feel like I could pull it off. But
I might beat you to the punch. I'm sure you saw some of the superhero images we created last time. But there might be some Tim Burton images coming from everybody this week. So
I love it.
We might be able to help you visualize it. But Joe, thank you again for your time. Really enjoyed the conversation, and I think we'll continue to invite you. We have events scheduled for the rest of the year. It's just like we started this first one by luck, and now we just can't give up on it.
Awesome. I love it.
But I don't know what point we're in 72 hours. Anyone watching this? But let's keep it going. Hope you're enjoying your Halloween. You got bisontrails.co. Students, go figure out how you guys want to build on this. Bug Bison Trails.
Yes. Surprise us.
Yep. You got Patrick McLean. You got Joe LaLuce. I hope I didn't butcher that.
You got
appreciate
it.
Your time, Joe.
Thanks for having me.
Have a good one.
Have a good one.